John Pilger's here tonight to prove that Australia's gift to British journalism isn't just Rupert Murdoch. John came to this country at a time when a lot of great Australian journalists and writers like Clive James, Barry Humphreys, Bruce Page, pretty much the backbone of Britain's investigative journalist tradition, came here when John came here. John was born in Bondi, Sydney, Australia. After he left school, he completed a course at the Australian Consolidated Press, which he called one of the strictest language courses he knew. It was a very tough school of editing and writing where he learned his trade. He came to Europe. He didn't come first to London. He went to Italy, and he set up a news agency called Interrep, which ran for a couple of years before it went broke. He came to London and went to work at Reuters, which is another good place to learn one's trade. And then he moved to the Daily Mirror, which was Britain's best-selling newspaper at the time. He became chief foreign correspondent and reported from all over the world, mainly from Vietnam during the American War in Vietnam, where his reporting was distinctive for its critical look at the American War in Vietnam, rather than the gung-ho reporting that was done by most of the Western press at the time. He received Britain's highest award for journalism, the Journalist of the Year Award, and he was the first reporter to win it twice. He then went to the United States, covered the civil rights marches, and then took part in the civil rights marches, marched with Martin Luther King. He was in Los Angeles at the Ambassador Hotel on the night that Robert Kennedy was killed. He was covering the Kennedy campaign, which, had it succeeded, might have ended the Vietnam War many years before it ended. He covered more, did more stories in Vietnam and Cambodia. He made many documentary films, including one on the Khmer Rouge takeover of Cambodia called Year Zero, The Silent Death of Cambodia. I think he's known to all of you, or you wouldn't be here. I'm not going to go through this list of his awards because it covers several pages, from 1966, Descriptive Writer of the Year, on through most recently this past year. He is a writer of books, an editor of books, including a great book of collected works of investigative journalism, which I would recommend that all of you read. And he's a great documentarian. So I would like to welcome Australia's fine journalist, and also Britain's fine journalist, John Pilger. That's okay. You deserve it.
I've forgotten most of it.
So, tell me, the format of this, we're going to talk a little bit between ourselves, which you're welcome to eavesdrop on. Then we're going to show some clips from some of John's old and newer documentary films. But first of all, I'm wondering why you came to this country in the first place.
My generation got on the ships that the new generation was arriving on. I mean, the Australian government had the interesting immigration banner then of populate or perish, because they imagined that the yellow peril was about to fall down on them as if by the force of gravity.
Is that when there was still the whites-only immigration policy?
Yes, pretty much. Pretty much. It was starting to loosen up. But Australia had worked through all the whitest people in the world they could find. They're running out of white people. so at that stage, southern Europeans were suspect, you know. But by default, this extraordinary multi-ethnic group of humanity started arriving in Australia, because it was policy to literally populate the country. And all these very unseaworthy, mostly Greek-owned ships were arriving. I and several others followed the moving belt of my generation, got on one as it discharged Greeks and Italians one day and took us the next. It was just, you felt long before the before air travel. I mean, there's plenty of air travel, but it was expensive then, that you did have a sense that you were, even though you'd born and grown up in the Antipodes, that you were far away. My father used to resent this. He said, you're not far away if you come from here. But I questioned that because I had no objections to Australia. A few of my compatriots, like Clive James, seemed to think that they were culturally starved. I didn't. I thought Australia was an extraordinary country at that time of my life, very early 20s. So I left, and the idea was to travel the world and see what happened. My mother, standing on the wharf, knew exactly what was happening, and she said, "You'll never come back." And I said, "Yes, I will." Well, I did, of course, year after year. But it's true, I didn't come back. And quite a few of us didn't. When I arrived here, I did discover, I was shocked to find that there was actually more freedom here. It was here, that it was even more informal. Australia was quite a grey Anglo-Irish society, certainly changing rapidly at that point, and it was quite a strict society in terms of what you could see and hear and read and so on. I'm not sure that I was particularly aware of that, but I was struck arriving in London in the 60s that there was something about here that appealed to me. So I didn't go back. I got a job. I didn't go back, and family and all the rest of it.
Did you set out to make your mark in world journalism? Was that one of the draws that took you away?
Yeah, I think so. I mean,
could you not have done that from Australia?
Eh?
Could you not have done that from Australia?
No.
I see.
No. I enjoyed journalism in Australia very much, and I had a terrific apprenticeship. There was then a cadet training scheme in Australia that actually taught you how to do it and taught you very well. And I think Australia expats, Australia's always produced quite accomplished reporters. I think we learn how to do it. And there's a long tradition of Australians coming here and doing that. No, I realized within, I suppose, a couple of years that what I wanted to do, and that was to be a journalist who really traveled the world. I mean, it was a pretty simple ambition at that point. In traveling the world, a great deal happened to me personally. There's no doubt about that. But that's what I wanted to do when I came here, and you could do it from here.
And you're known for your politics. You're an engaged, committed journalist. You're not just a reporter.
I don't think I'm as committed as establishment reporters.
I'm not going to contradict you on that. No, but I'm just. Oh. But I'm wondering if. You were always.
Sorry,
that,
I have
if you
to
were
say
always,
that, John.
No, that's fair.
That's
if you were always that way, or did your politics move to the left as you saw the world and you saw Vietnam and saw Cambodia, or were you always a young man of the left, a firebrand?
Look, I don't know. I grew up in considering the times. I grew up, and there was a McCarthy period in Australia, as there was in the United States. It was missed here, and I grew up in a family that I only probably realized later how political it was, or at least how resistant it was. Particularly my father, was very aware of class in Australia. None of it was formalized. My father had been a member of the Australian chapter of the Wobblies back in the early part of the century. But it was, I suppose it was a family that, as my mother once said, we're for the underdog. I think I asked her when I was young. What's it about? He said, well, we're for the underdog. And that's about as written down as it got. I mean, the only sort of self-analysis of this period, I suppose I allow myself, is that I was fiercely anti-authority. And have always been that.
That's an Australian trait, generally.
It's meant to be. It's not really. No. Australia, you know, I mean, Australians like to think they're anti-authority, but, yeah, they're not really. I mean, we did grow up with the advantage of being told by our parents to hate all policemen. It was true. You know, you never trust a policeman and hate them all and have nothing to do with them. But whenever a policeman appeared, we'd be very deferential to them, which is very wise. So that sort of showed the contradiction in the Australian character. Really.
So when you left and you started covering the world, what was your first big story, the story that most grabbed you?
Look, I suppose the thing that really had the impact on me was that I was fortunate enough to arrive here when, and it seems eons ago now, when the Daily Mirror was becoming an extraordinary newspaper. It was then being run by Hugh Cudlip, who had great ambitions for it. This was a paper, unchallenged, that 1 in 4 of the population read, 5 million circulation it reached in 1967. And he, almost in a sort of slightly Victorian way, decided that the readers were going to know that we were going to campaign, which the Mirror had always done, but we are now going to campaign and investigate to an extraordinary depth for a tabloid newspaper. In fact, the whole idea of tabloid as a pejorative term wasn't really known then. And we were going to, as it were, open a map of the world to our readers. In the 60s, they started a thing called Mirroscope, which ran over 6 pages without an ad. And wherever I was writing from, I could get up to 2,000 words in a tabloid paper. It was, you know, we know how difficult that is to get that in a broadsheet or anywhere now. And so I was fortunate in that I collided with that change. It didn't last long, but it had a very big impact on me and gave me the chance to report from parts of the world that I would never have seen otherwise. I've never, like Latin America and Africa and India. And I think seeing, and my own country, I was sent by the Mirror to report on the indigenous people of Australia. And I'd only ever seen a handful of them growing up in Sydney as distant figures living near Botany Bay. And I was sent to the far west of New South Wales and near Alice Springs to report on the indigenous people of Australia. And, you know, I went through, I suppose, a series of shocks, actually. I never imagined this. I never imagined the world was like this. So that answers your early question, perhaps, in that those first few years of reporting from the so-called third world had a considerable impact on me and has influenced me ever since. It's certainly the early question that I raised. Well, this hasn't happened as an act of God. Why? You know, what's causing this?
So that begins to inform your political.
Oh yeah, right from the beginning. Why? Mm. Why is this going on? You know, so I didn't see people. Many people were and are victims, but I don't think I saw them that way. Mm. I wanted to know why they're in that state. And why these countries were, in this was the post-colonial time, and it took me to South Africa, and it introduced me to, you know, I arrive in South Africa during the apartheid years and be welcomed by nice liberal South Africans. Oh, you're an Australian. Oh, you understand, you know. You deal with the problem over there. And, you know, this was very illuminating for me.
When were you in Vietnam?
I first went to Vietnam in 1966.
What did you think at that time?
It terrified me. Saigon was a strange, raucous, wild place in many ways, and I fell in the company of a lot of reporters who helped me and introduced me to the rest of Vietnam. I didn't go there with any idea that this was an especially wrong war. The reason I didn't was that I knew very little about it. I didn't know the history, and you have to know the history. I mean, it became apparent, I worked back, because I went, the following year, I went down to the Mekong Delta, where a whole string of villages had been hit by napalm, and I followed what happened to this one particular village. That I thought was, why is this happening? How is, all the questions then arose for me that this was a war as Martha Gellhorn, who became later a very good friend of mine, reported that year. I mean, she was really the first, I think, to identify that this was a war against civilians and the precursor of so many wars now. So that experience I had then certainly informed how I would approach the war. I mean, the coverage of the war was often, as you know, Charlie, the coverage of the war was often done by very, very good reporters who reported a lot of these so-called mistakes and blunders, but it was still seen as well-intentioned. It wasn't well-intentioned. Nothing about it was well-intentioned. The victims were also the GIs, and particularly the conscripted ones. And I think starting to understand how Vietnam happened really changed me very quickly, actually.
And were you able to publish everything you wrote?
Yeah.
Because the Mirror was...
Well, the Mirror and ran a front page, which I have on my office wall at home. All over the front page, how can Britain approve a war like this? Can you imagine that now? Well, it did happen briefly, of course, in the run-up to the Iraq War. When I went back to the Mirror for about 18 months. I didn't go back as such, but I wrote for them for 18 months. So that was, I mean, in those days, the media responded to the tremendous changes that were going on around the world. That in the United States, it was as if the margins were moving in. And they did respond to them. There's no doubt about that.
But they had to.
They had to. Mm. They had to. No, no. But and it took a while for the reaction to sink
years.
In.
A few years.
Took a few years. Yeah, it's like everything. It's like like the Congress of the 1970s. You know, can you imagine
The Church Committee, the Pike Committee.
The Church Committee. Can you imagine Church Committee in 1975? One of the most extraordinary investigations into journalism and into
CIA.
Its.
Hmm? The journalism and the CIA.
And Jones, the CIA. Yeah. I mean, if you want to, I think, frankly, Carl Bernstein's perhaps last great piece was in Rolling Stone in 1977 when he he described what had happened there. Can you imagine anything like that happening today? And the same applied to the media.
Speaking of your return to the Mirror, I just read in The Guardian a few days ago, the 18th of June, an excerpt from the diary of Alistair Campbell. I don't know if you've seen
this. Oh, yeah, I read that.
This is what Alistair wrote in his diary entry for Tuesday, the 13th of May, 2003. Lunch with Piers Morgan, then editor. We met at the Savoy Grill. He was in appeasing mood. Said he hadn't ballsed up the war. Said he hadn't ballsed up the war. Had lost 60,000 readers through that. 120,000 to the price war, and he accepted he had fucked up. He knew he wasn't in a strong position with us, but said he wanted to come back in a bit, needed to get rid of John Pilger, cut down on Paul Rutledge, stop whacking Cherie Blair, get back to being more positive on the domestic agenda. This is how politics and journalism are done.
Well, you know, if you believe Campbell, I mean, Campbell is promoted by The Guardian, but Campbell is, you know, the chief collaborator to war criminal. And the vicarious promotion of Campbell is one of the most sickening sides of so-called respectable media at the moment. He's never out of the pages of The Guardian. He's never off Newsnight. And we have to know about his depression and everything else. What about depression of all the tens of thousands of widows in Iraq and so on? Piers may have said that. Piers was,
It seems that he was offering you up as a sacrificial lamb to get back in the good graces of the Burrows.
Well, he's offering me. It's interesting. At the Leveson inquiry, Jeremy Paxman grasped on Piers and said that Piers had told him how to hack a phone. He'd gone to lunch. Mm. At the Mirror and told him how to hack a phone. What he didn't say was that he'd gone to lunch, actually, I worked it out, in early 2002, when the Mirror was then, under Piers, the only newspaper that was uncompromisingly against the Iraq war and reflecting the majority of the people in this country.
And the Independent. The Independent.
Not uncompromisingly, no. Okay. No, it wasn't, actually. But the Mirror was, and why Piers did it, I don't know, but he certainly did it until he himself made some rather serious misjudgments and he was out. But I suppose the point about that is that the Leveson inquiry, which is very much the club that always appreciates the likes of Alistair Campbell and others, has not even mentioned that the media's greatest and most disreputable role has been in the promotion of wars that have cost vast numbers of lives and devastated countries, that make hacking phones seem like a misdemeanor by comparison. I mean, the Leveson inquiry is like some club, you know, that they... one of the members has got out of hand, so he needs to be, it's, he got embarrassing, so you've got to blackball him, basically so that nothing will change, and that's what's going to happen. There'll be a few things, and we might have to publish in the papers apologies here and there and so on. But this extraordinary waffle shop.
So to what do you attribute this overwhelmingly inconsistent pro-war sentiment in the press?
To the structure of the press. The press, the media, is most of the media is an extension of established order, power. It is in any, that's how media, with very considerable and outstanding and often very honourable exceptions. But it is an extension. And you see that absolutely exemplified in the Westminster Media Club, where they all go and talk to each other, and the same thing is, and scratch each other's backs, and basically present the news in terms of personalities. Sometimes attack one or two, but basically go along with it. Cameron was given the easiest ride he could possibly have.
As was Blair.
The only person who spoke about Blair was some bloke, a filmmaker who was in the audience, who suggested that Blair be arrested. And of course, Lord Leveson actually apparently jumped up. He was so shocked that anyone should utter anything that was near to the truth. And apologised to the war criminal and got rid of the truth teller.
It was ever thus. Now, I want, if we can, we have short clips of some of John's documentary films that have been made over the years. And I think it'd probably be better, I have the order here, it'd probably be better if you introduce them than I do, because they're your films. They're 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
I've got to drop my glasses. Oh, okay. That's the problem.
I can lend you mine.
Eh?
Well, this is a bigger type. It might be.
They've gone somewhere.
I've done it 16 point for myself, so that might
I can't read that, sorry. That is a disaster. Oh, thank you. Yeah. Damn. Right, wow. Yes, okay. What would you like me to read, John?
This is the order of we're going to show the film clips.
Yeah,
the first
okay.
one is Quiet Mutiny, Vietnam 1970. It's a very short clip. It's a news report.
Yeah, okay. Right. You'd like me to describe
just to
what they are?
Just introduce it, yeah.
Okay. Well, The Quiet Mutiny was my first one. It was made for World in Action, which was a series, as some of you will know, for Granada Television. And it really investigated the mutiny that was then underway in the U.S. Army in Vietnam, brought about by the arrival of the so-called 68 generation, the drafted soldiers, and some of whom were fragging their officers, that is, killing them, unpopular officers, refusing to go out on patrols, refusing to have anything to do with the war. So I'd been working on this story for some time, and I did it as a World in Action, and it went out in 1970, and it introduced me to the instant power of television to get you into trouble. And the US ambassador was then a close friend of Richard Nixon called Walter Annenberg, who was a big media press proprietor in the U.S.
The racing form.
Yeah, racing form.
And his father was a bookmaker.
Yeah. And he...
which is illegal in America.
Well, he was terribly upset by this and complained bitterly to what was then the Independent Television Authority, the regulatory authority, which was run by a compatriot of mine who had a knighthood called Sir Something Robert Fraser, I think. And he called the Granada people in and described me all the things I couldn't admit to you earlier, in which I wasn't, described me as a Marxist and communist and a, you know, general threat. And Granada defended the film wonderfully, actually. Sidney Bernstein, the founder of Granada, defended it because what he didn't like was the expose, of course. So that was the first film.
So we're going to show that now? Yes, okay.
The war isn't over, but it is ending. It is ending not because of the Paris talks or the demonstrations at home. It is ending because the largest and wealthiest and most powerful organization on earth, the American Army, is being challenged from within, from the very cellars of its pyramid, from the most forgotten, the most brutalized, and certainly the bravest of its members. The war is ending because the grunt is taking no more bullshit.
Hey, this is the first time bullshit. I wrote down bullshit, and I had a fantastic director I was working with. I always worked with BBC Renegades. God, they were great. And Charles Denton, who went on to distinguish things in television, and he's distinguished there, of course. But he, I, I didn't know how to do any of this. I said, how do I do it? And he said, well, I'm not telling you, just do it the way you think it should be done, which is the best advice, because so I wasn't given. But still, I wrote down, well, camera piece, bullshit. It was only just a word to myself. And I showed it to him, and I had no intention of saying it. And he said, say it. And I said, well, I can't say bullshit. So, I started to draw back from this. So he said, no, say it. He said, this is to hell. Well, let's do it. And when the film, to get to Australia, that film had to be, they then had a censorship in Australia. Granada sold it on to Channel 9 in Australia. And when the censor released it, there was a question over, not over what it was saying, but over the fact that I was saying bullshit. So it did go out very late at night with a bleep on bullshit, which of course drew enormous amount of attention to it. But
it was the GI argo at the time. It was appropriate for
Yeah, that absolutely. Piece, yeah. That's what GI, that's what they said. I was, I'd lived weeks with them and lying in the mud with them, and they became friends and all of that, and it was bullshit. The war was bullshit, and it was a wonderful English word and American word and whatever word, but Charles was right.
Now the next,
is Millicent here? Millicent, I just remember where I left my glasses. They're in the loo. Thank you. Well, I'm sorry, but you might have to get a man to go in there.
Then there's the next.
Oh, sorry, the next one. Year Zero was 1979, made for ITV. All my films, bar a handful, have been made for ITV. Again, I mean, I had sort of parallel careers, because I was working for Fleet Street and working for television at the same time. And they actually complemented each other extremely well, because I could spend quite a lot of time as a newspaper reporter. Thank you very much. Thank you. In investigating the story and preparing it and doing the research for television, I hadn't been into, no one had been into Cambodia after Pol Pot took over in 1975, but I'd done a lot of work around the border and made quite a few contacts in Paris, where there was a possibility of getting into Cambodia, not during the Pol Pot raid. I had to wait till the Vietnamese threw out Pol Pot, and then very shortly after that, I took a camera crew into Cambodia. It had a, I suppose I describe more in the clip what I was seeing, but I'd never seen, or probably had never seen, anything like it since. Phnom Penh was not quite deserted, but it had dispossessed people, mainly children, living in sort of offices. None of the buildings had been affected. They're all dilapidated because the Khmer Rouge force marched the population out of Phnom Penh when they took over, although Pol Pot and his circle did base themselves in that. So people had begun, when I got there, to drift back to it, and it was an aftermath of an apocalyptic situation. There's no doubt about that. And the surreal was everywhere, such as the National Bank of Cambodia had been blown up by the Khmer Rouge as they fled, and money, new banknotes made by De La Rue in London, had poured out of the bank in the monsoon. And so the streets of Phnom Penh, the most impoverished and devastated city in the world at that point, were running with brand new money, brand new banknotes. The state of people, particularly of children, was really awful. There was anthrax, there was smallpox that even started to come back on the other side of the country. Everybody was in a pretty bad way. Now, during this time, the Cold War had kicked in because the Vietnamese who liberated Cambodia, which they did, that Pol Pot had been attacking them for a couple of years, they attacked back, they liberated the country. They weren't going to get off lightly for this. The liberators of Cambodia had come from the wrong side of the Cold War. It'd be much better if the Thais had liberated them, but there's no question of the Thais of liberating them. So Cambodia, an embargo, a Western embargo, was clamped on Cambodia. It's often forgotten, but there was almost a 10-year embargo on Cambodia following the overthrow of Pol Pot.
And there was already an American embargo on Vietnam. And there was already the American embargo
on Vietnam. On Vietnam. So they just extended it. Mm. And only a couple of small NGOs in a brief radical period, the likes of Oxfam did extraordinary work there because they were the only ones. UNICEF was there, certainly, but they're all up against it to deal with this devastation, this stricken country, stricken in so many ways, psychologically. I mean, it had almost had a massive nervous breakdown as well. So year zero showed this. Now, it showed and attempted to say why.
Should we see that?
A horror began almost immediately. Phnom Penh, a city of 2.5 million people, was forcibly emptied within hours of their coming, the sick and wounded being dragged from their hospital beds, dying children being carried in plastic bags, the old and crippled being dumped beside the road, and all of them being marched at gunpoint into the countryside and toward a totally new society, the like of which we have never known. The new rulers of Cambodia call 1975 Year Zero, the dawn of an age in which there would be no families, no sentiment, no expressions of love or grief, no medicines, no hospitals, no schools, no books, no learning, no holidays, no music, no song, no post, no money, only work and death.
Out of the inferno of bombs came Pol Pot, a former Buddhist monk, and the Khmer Rouge, whose revolution had never enjoyed a popular base until Nixon's madman theory of war. In all but a few places, there is no electricity and no sewerage. The water supply is polluted by the bodies of countless murdered and tortured men, women, and children. And the jungle has reclaimed their homes.
And here is one of the more grotesque ironies of it all. The Khmer Rouge banned all forms of money, and yet they had printed millions of these brand new banknotes. And just before the Vietnamese drove into the city last year, the Khmer Rouge blew up the National Bank, and the monsoon rains carried all this money through the city. And today, a city that has nothing is literally running with money. All of it worthless.
I mean, the reaction to that film was probably unprecedented. It went out, as documentaries don't do these days, at 9 o'clock on ITV. In fact, when we came back from Cambodia, ITV was then blacked out. There was a strike by the union. And the union gave it dispensation. And so ITV was going to light up for one program. Then the strike was settled. But it had a huge audience, about 12 million people. It was the reaction to it was in unsolicited terms just amazing. It raised millions. The BBC, on the basis of an ITV program, started a campaign to raise money through schools here called Bring It By, and they raised in a week £1 million from schools. It raised about £30 million, which was a lot of money then, and we kept control. We did keep control of most of it and ensured that it went to very structural programs in Cambodia. It was shown all over the world, with the exception of the United States. The rest of the film is very critical of the embargo which was then imposed on Cambodia. I took it to PBS in Washington and sat down with a number of public broadcasting, sat down with a number of their executives who saw it and were clearly impressed. They wanted the footage. Well, they weren't having the footage. They had to have the whole film.
What do you mean is they wanted the footage so they could cut their own film?
Yeah, you know, this was all exclusive. This was the first film, basically, full-length film from the Pol Pot period. And so I said, no, you have to show it as it is. I went back to the hotel and waited, and I got a call saying, look, we'd like to, we're going to get a journalistic adjudicator. I mean, and I said, what's that? And they said, well, we're getting a distinguished journalist to say if he thinks that your film is impartial and credible. Well, I said, well, it's not impartial. It's for, otherwise I would have had Mr. Pot in it. And so anyway, they went off and they found this guy called Richard Dudman. Do you remember him?
Sure.
Yeah. Well. He had quite a liberal reputation.
He did.
But he was one of a small group that had been invited by Pol Pot. There were five who went to Pol Pot, including...
After 75.
No, during the Pol Pot. They're the only foreigners who'd gone there. One of them was an academic called Malcolm Corwell.
Who was killed.
Who was murdered.
Yes, I remember.
During this trip by the Khmer Rouge. But incredibly, Dudman came back, and he wrote then for the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. He wrote rather warmly about the Khmer Rouge, their great housing program and agricultural projects and things. So he was an apologist. Extraordinary stuff. He was the one they brought in as an adjudicator, because he did that. Yeah. And that was the end of it. And it was...
He had to look pretty hard for an adjudicator who was on the side of the Khmer Rouge in America. They weren't
it was difficult. Difficult. I mean, they went through hoops.
Although by 79, the U.S. had already begun helping the Khmer Rouge to come back.
Well, they were still supporting the United Nations. In fact, they insisted that the Pol Pot's representatives in all the international bodies, UN, World Health Program, stay there. Mm. And then, of course, the Khmer Rouge were an integral part of the resistance on the border to the regime being set up by the Vietnamese.
Now let's talk about the next piece.
Right. This is Death of a Nation. The full title, I think, is Death of a Nation, the Timor Conspiracy. It was 1993. This was a film, East Timor had really disappeared from the media.
Not that it had ever made much of an
appearance. It had been, the Indonesians invaded East Timor in 1975, same year as Pol Pot. And during that time, they killed more people proportionally than Pol Pot had killed in Cambodia. About a third of the population either were killed or starved to death by them, this former little Portuguese colony. Because Indonesia was so important to the US, to Britain, Britain supplied most of its arms, especially to Australia, they supported the Suharto regime, and trying to keep East Timor under the carpet was difficult, but they did achieve
it. They killed five Australian journalists who tried to...
They killed five... The five they killed at Balibo during the invasion in 1975, Greg Shackleton led this television team from Channel 7 in Australia. I used his camera piece in this film. It is one of the most moving, finest pieces of journalism I've seen. He knew they knew that the Indonesians were about to invade, and the truth was that the Australian government, all the governments, knew that they were about to invade. The Australian government knew that those journalists were in peril, that they would almost certainly be killed, and of course the cables have since shown that to be true. I'm sorry that that was actually left out of an otherwise impressive film about Balibo. So that was really the last, I suppose, hard reporting from inside East Timor. Did a lot of planning. We planned it for a year, and the whole film was shot undercover, where four of us went in differently, separately. David Munro and I went in together with cameras. Then, of course, you have a camera and your eyeball practically, but now, then you had a small Hi-8, and we made these
bags
with the camera sticking out. So we did all that stuff. And pre-digital, you know. And we came out with... We came out with an extraordinary film, I thought.
Let's
take a look. Show 93.
What happened here 18 years ago happened mostly in secret, and this filming is being done in secret without the approval or knowledge of the Indonesian authorities. Journalists and independent observers are not welcome in East Timor. Two Australian television teams, including two Britons, were murdered here in 1975 by the Indonesian army for trying to breach the wall of silence that the regime in Jakarta and its Western allies had built around East Timor. As a result of the Indonesian invasion and occupation, some 200,000 people died here. That's a third of the population, or proportionately more than were killed in Cambodia under Pol Pot.
You knew in advance, didn't you, that the Indonesian invasion was going to happen, and you forewarned...
Well, we'd say knew in advance from sort of assessing the situation as it was developing. I did come to the conclusion, as did a number of other ambassadors in Jakarta in 1975, that Indonesian intervention was inevitable in these circumstances.
We were providing most of the weaponry, helicopters, logistical support, food, uniforms, ammunition, all the expendables that the Indonesians needed to conduct this war.
When Henry Kissinger returned to Washington, he summoned his senior aides. According to the minutes of that meeting, Kissinger expressed his fear that the Congress and public would find out about his complicity with the Suharto regime. Kissinger,
On the Timor thing, that will leak in 3 months, and it will come out that Kissinger overruled his pristine bureaucrats and violated the law. How many people know about this? Staff member. 3. Kissinger, plus everybody in this meeting. Everything on paper will be used against me. Can't we construe a communist government in the middle of Indonesia as self-defense? One of the biggest prizes for the West is the Timor Gap oil treaty between Indonesia and Australia, which allows foreign companies to exploit the huge oil and gas reserves in the seabed off East Timor. Portugal has taken Australia to the World Court over the legality of the treaty. According to Professor Roger Clark, a world authority on international law, the treaty makes the Australian government a receiver of stolen property. This is Australian Foreign Affairs Minister Gareth Evans and Indonesian Foreign Minister Ali Alatas. They're flying over the oil fields of Timor, toasting each other as they celebrate the treaty and the division of spoils.
I think if you think back over the whole period, the other agreements, the relationship we've had has been very significant, very important. But this is really unique and uniquely important. And for that reason, it's really quite an historic occasion that we're now witnessing today.
Gareth Evans is wandering the world at the moment he was running the International Crisis Group for a while. I'm not sure that he is, but he's a great promoter of what's a piece of jargon, lethal piece of jargon called responsibility to protect.
R2P.
R2P, correct. He makes a lot of speeches all over the place about this. So in other words, humanitarian intervention, which basically means invading countries. He promoted the invasion of Libya, he promoted the invasion of Syria if he could, he's promoted all the invasions around the place. And yet he sees himself as a kind of an international intellectual or something or other. But he is the embodiment of he's no worse than most of those with power who represent us or say they represent us. But there's something about him that is particularly obnoxious, and it gave me great pleasure to use that sequence.
I'm sure he wishes you hadn't.
Yes.
We can reach with the next clip.
Yes. Inside Burma. These are all the hard ones. Inside Burma was also shot completely undercover, and we got, David Munro and I got in as tourists and teamed up with some people and managed to prove that police states can be very inefficient, and filmed quite a lot of the child labor, which was then and still is the backbone of that awful regime. During that, we managed to get in and see Aung San Suu Kyi, and I had a long interview with her. So that's 1998.
Can we look at that now? Thank you.
This is a film about the right of a people to freedom and the power of the human spirit to resist against overwhelming odds. It's the story of Burma, once known as the Golden Land. On the surface, everything appears serene. It's a country of extraordinary beauty and gracious people. But Burma is also a secret country, isolated for the past 34 years since a brutal dictatorship seized power. the assault on its people all but forgotten. To tell their story, we had to go undercover. What we found was a land of fear.
It's just after dawn beside Inya Lake in the center of Rangoon. We're filming this with great care because even at this hour, it's almost certain we are being watched, which is a normal state of affairs for many Burmese. This causeway is known as the White Bridge. On March the 16th, 1988, hundreds of school children and students marched along it, singing the national anthem. Then as they looked behind them, they saw the steel helmets of the army, and they knew they were trapped. According to eyewitnesses, the soldiers beat many of them to death, singling out the girls.
Suu Kyi remained a prisoner for 6 years. Alone in this house on University Avenue, she was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. Her whispered name became a byword, and people would pass her house just to be reassured by the sound of her playing her piano.
What were the most difficult times to you personally during your house arrest?
There were times when I was worried for my colleagues. And there were times when I worried for our people out there when they seemed to be undergoing a lot of oppression. And I worried about my sons very much because the young one was only 12.
Were you able to stay in touch with Michael during that time?
Not throughout that time. There were times when we were out of touch.
For how long was there?
I think the longest period was for about 2 years and 4 months or 5 months, something like that.
No letters or anything during that time? No letters from the children got through?
No.
Weren't there times when you were actually terrified?
No, because I didn't feel hostile towards them. This is what people don't seem to understand. They say, well, you must have been terrified, but why? I didn't feel hostile towards the guards or the soldiers surrounding me. And I think fear comes out of hostility.
It was before her husband died, and she couldn't leave to go back to him. So it's, I imagine watching her being celebrated as this year, a little while ago, everywhere.
Were there any repercussions against her because of this interview at that time?
Not that I know of. At that stage, you could. You could actually phone her. I phoned her over a couple of years. She would pick up the phone. I had her number, and we'd have a brief conversation. I sent out through a photographer friend of mine. I asked her the books she wanted, and I sent out a lot of books to her. So this was a period when, between her house, she was out of official house arrest. She was effectively under house arrest. She couldn't leave University Avenue, effectively. But then she was placed a year or so late. She was placed under the house arrest from which she's recently emerged.
What's our next clip?
Welcome to Australia, which was 1999. And I've made a number of films about Indigenous Australia since I suppose first discovered the state of the Indigenous people in my own country, as I described earlier. I'm making one at the moment, and that's the last one. It was Welcome to Australia was made just prior to the Sydney Olympics, and it was about sport and Indigenous people. Sport, of course, is often the way Australia expresses its nationalism. So it's very, as we all know, it's very cricket and everything else is very close to the hearts of many, many Australians. But the story of Aboriginal sports people is not so well known.
This remarkable photograph, taken shortly after the Melbourne Olympics, is of the Rovers football team. It vividly represents life and death in Black Australia. All these young players were Aboriginal, and all of them are now dead. Most died in their 30s and 40s. Their tragedy represents the epic suffering of the Aboriginal people whose living conditions are so bad that their life expectancy is among the lowest on Earth, worse than much of Africa. In his book Obstacle Race, Professor Colin Tatz names 1,200 outstanding Black Australian athletes, of whom only five had access to the equipment, training and facilities that white Australians take for granted.
The Aboriginal people who are going to represent Australia in the Olympics are aberrations. They're people who have shown sometimes twice, sometimes three times as much talent in order to rate equal and in order to rate a place. They're people who, through sheer talent, have been forced to be recognised. If we appropriate their talents, they become part of us and we look better for the whole exercise. I mean, Cathy Freeman is the greatest thing that's ever happened to white Australia in recent years, because this happy, smiling, grinning, delightful, fun-loving, life-loving young lady looks as though she is the representative of all black womanhood. She isn't.
I took this photograph at Jay Creek in the Northern Territory in 1969. It was my first real glimpse of the other Australia. There was no decent housing, no running water, and the children were sick. Charlie Perkins, another Aborigine derided as a half-caste, was my guide.
The discrimination just awful. The police were controlling us. If we went into the town, we'd be arrested and brought back to the compound. They called it a reserve, but it was a compound. I mean, I went to a birthday party, and we were invited, but we had to stay outside at the windows. We handed in our little presents to them, and they handed the cakes out to us. And then I was the best cricketer in this team in Adelaide, but I couldn't go into the pub with everybody else. I had to stand outside a window, and I didn't drink. I just to get my lemon squash even. I wasn't allowed inside. Everybody else was. To me, I thought that was natural. That was the way it had to be. Then I thought, no, this is not right. You know, why shouldn't I be in there? And I told the publican off a couple of times through the window. I told him to get stuffed and a few other things. So I was even banned from being outside the window.
The death of Eddie Murray is the Stephen Lawrence case of Australia. Eddie was 21 and a star rugby league player when he was found hanging in a police cell in the New South Wales town of Weewar in 1981. The coroner delivered an open verdict after hearing conflicting police evidence. Eddie's parents, Leela and Arthur Murray, have never stopped campaigning for justice.
I've suffered a lot, you know, over the years. I don't think I'd take any more. We need answers, John.
When do you think things will ever change in this country?
When we get justice for it, you know.
Leela died in 2004, and I was back in Weewar about a month ago filming with Arthur, and the long campaign goes on for recognition that Eddie Murray was killed by the police, which he was. The next one is Breaking the Silence, Truth and Lies in the War on Terror. That was 2003, when the Iraq invasion, the year of the Iraq invasion.
As we and our coalition partners are doing in Afghanistan, we will bring to the Iraqi people food and medicines and supplies and freedom.
So I believe that this is a fight for freedom. And I want to make it a fight for justice too.
We have shown freedom's power. And in this great conflict, my fellow Americans, we will see freedom's victory.
The problem with America is not that we go around marauding around the world imposing ourselves. Mm. The problem with America in the last 10, 15 years, since the end of the Cold War, really in the last 60 years, is that we've been too slow to get involved in conflicts.
Outside America, people have worried about the United States conducting an unprovoked attack on a country, a sovereign country.
Whether are they? Or not,
whether,
are they?
Yes, they are.
Really? They're worried we're going to attack Britain, France, Germany? Any democracy?
No, because
decent regime?
No, the United States doesn't usually attack strong countries.
Do we attack decent countries?
No, I said strong countries.
Well, I'm asking decent countries.
I don't know.
Are
what
people
you would
really
call,
worried the U.S. is going to go a decent, law-abiding country, and the U.S. is going to come in and say, "We don't like the look of you. We're going to depose you"? Is that something the U.S. has done quite often? How many countries has the U.S. attacked in the last 15 years?
Since World War II, there have been 72 interventions by the United States.
Oh, is that right?
Yes.
That's ludicrous.
Well, it's not ludicrous. It's true.
There are pleasures in this job.
Why did you pick Bill Kristol to interview?
Well, Bill Kristol represents the Weekly Standard, which is owned by Rupert Murdoch. There are a number of others from the administration. I interview several people from the administration in that film, the Bush administration. He was the most vocal. I mean, for the war, he didn't. He was in the of all those in Washington. I think he and represented the group that really took over the Bush administration and was completely unapologetic about it. There was still a debate about whether it was a wise thing for them to done, not as far as he was concerned. Right. The next one is the war on democracy. I feel my life slipping before me. You know, the war on democracy was my first feature documentary for cinema, and it was also shown on television. And it was it's about Latin America, or a number of countries in Latin America, Bolivia, Chile, and Venezuela, and others. And it really sets out to tell the story of the rise of Latin America of a number of countries in the last few years, from the state of political peonage, I suppose, to the U.S. mainly. Okay.
Dwayne Claridge was head of the CIA's Latin American division in the early 1980s.
Chile, the only reason it exists is because of Pinochet.
At a huge human price.
What human price? Give me a break.
The thousands who were disappeared and murdered?
Thousands? You count them. What thousands?
Well,
and
I've
don't
seen...
Talk to me about truth commissions.
I've seen their names in the cemetery in Santiago.
Yeah,
You're saying they're fakes.
There aren't thousands.
Well...
There aren't thousands, sir.
There are thousands, each name documented by human rights organizations. It was a period in which almost everybody in the present situation regards as a dark time in which the CIA played a major role.
That's right. They played a major role in overthrowing, what's his name?
What's his name was Salvador Allende.
Yeah, fine, okay.
He was democratically elected.
Right, okay.
Is that okay to overthrow a democratically elected government? Is it okay?
It depends on what your national security interests are.
Y vivir dignamente, ese es el objetivo. No convertirnos en millonarios, el American way of life, no. Esa es una imbecilidad. Eso te lo digo un poco para... porque el tema de la pobreza es un tema al que somos muy sensibles y es el que nos lleva la mayor parte de nuestra lucha de todos los días.
The daily struggle is made easier here. 10 years ago, this clinic would not have been dreamed of. Now, all over Venezuela, ordinary people have free health care, many seeing a doctor for the first time in their lives. There is now close to full literacy, thanks to classes like this, catering to those like Mavis Mendez, age 95, now reading and writing for the first time.
In a little tent, oh, and just like the river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard. But I'm afraid to die, 'cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes it will.
I first heard Sam Cooke sing that during the, when I was reporting the civil rights campaign in the US. And I thought it's very long, it goes on for about 4 minutes. I think it's one of the most extraordinary political songs. And I've had it in my head to put on a film since, and that was the right film. And I asked the estate of Sam Cooke through the agents in New York, could I have it? And they said, sure, that'll be $100,000. I talked them into it, and I got world rights for nothing. And when they saw the film, and it plays well at the end of that film.
I think there's one more clip.
Well, this was last year, year before, The War You Don't See. The War You Don't See is about war and media, and the role of Western media, free media, in the promotion of wars. Centered on Iraq, the role it took is a transatlantic, it took the US and UK medias, broadcasting. Not entirely, but almost all about broadcasting. So it took the BBC and ITV. I made it for ITV, and the agreement was that if we did the BBC, we'd do ITV. So it was interesting how the way that played out. On the other side of the Atlantic, I
interviewed people like Dan Rather and about the role that particularly broadcasting has played in the promotion of the not only post 9/11 wars before that, not simply about embedded. It examined the whole notion of embedding, not as one simply of being embedded with an army. I've been embedded with armies. That does place certain restrictions, but they're pretty well defined often. It's about the whole notion of embedding, that is, the embedding in your head, the embedding in the studio, the embedding with a whole series of assumptions, of values, of taking at face value what you're told by various arms of authority, and it examined that. So,
there 1 o'clock.
Once you get on, just open it up.
Yeah, Roger. I see you.
Light them all up.
Come on, fire.
Hey, Roger.
And it also examined the rise of WikiLeaks.
That first bit of video came from
WikiLeaks. Yes, that was WikiLeaks when WikiLeaks really broke through, which that's the footage that Bradley Manning allegedly leaked, and it was a making of that film, although I'd met him before, but I'd long interview with Julian Assange, and we described in the film what WikiLeaks did, I think most importantly, it suggests, and I mentioned Leveson, the Leveson inquiry at the beginning of this, it suggests that until we look at what the respectable media does, instead of identifying the very obvious bad apples, so-called, then we'll never understand the insidious effect of media in the promotion.
Do you explain in the film, or could you tell us now, why is it that after every war, whether it's Vietnam or the invasion of Iraq or Afghanistan, for every war, the press beats its breast and says, they lied to us, but we will never fall for that again. And then another war comes along, and they lie to them, and they report the lies as if they were truth again.
Yeah, well,
why?
Because I'm not sure they say, well, they always say they lied to us.
The Gulf of Tonkin, for example.
Yes.
Yeah. Weapons of mass destruction,
everyone,
for example.
Korea, go back before that. I mean, this film goes back to Wilfred Burchett's extraordinary scoop of World War II, and on the day that the embedded press was being shepherded to go to the USS Missouri to witness this great ceremonial act of General MacArthur taking the surrender of the Japanese, a media event, and plus Burchett slipped the leash and made this perilous journey to Hiroshima. And another one on my wall is his front page all over the broadsheet of the Daily Express. And the headline says the atomic plague, and he wrote the first story about this being radioactivity, this being radiation was part of it. Incredibly, up to then, they were saying that people had died merely as a result of the blast. It was a new weapon, but there wasn't this. And he, this was, and he paid for this. He, when he got back, and there's an interview I did with Wilfred Burchett before he died in the 1980s in this film, in which he describes how he was attacked by fellow journalists who were upset that he'd broken the embedding code. So it goes, look, it goes right back. I mean, you know, the reporter of Waterloo was Wellington himself, you know.
Well, that's fair.
you know, and, you know, the great reporter of the Crimea was another Wilfred Burchett type character. But I suppose as media and journalism have covered itself in a kind of, in a mythology, I believe this actually started with journalism, the growth of journalism schools, such as the Columbia School of Journalism, that giving itself a self-importance, that we are objective and impartial, and we're above all this, and that, you know, we have, we are genuinely, as as Edmund Burke described, fourth estate, and all that, that mystical stuff about the media. It's basically nonsense.
It's a craft.
Yeah, it's a craft, and there are plenty of, yes, there are times to when you can be objective and impartial and all those things, but trying to get at the truth might be the best way of being a journalist.
In this regard, I would recommend your anthology, to please, Tell Me No Lies, because it's a very good representations of good, solid investigative journalism in that. The other one I recommend is Philip Knightley's The First Casualty.
Oh,
about,
wonderful.
About war correspondence, the history of war correspondence from the Crimea to now.
Yeah. Which blows the lid off it.
Mm? Blows the lid off the mythology.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's nothing, there's nothing new, but technology gives it a new power. And journalists themselves, broadcasters themselves, are really under the whip to produce material. Now we have this ludicrous medium of Twitter, which is, actually it's not all that ludicrous, it exposes the ludicrous. The ludicrous expose themselves as being ludicrous. But I see the other day even awards being given out for...
For the best Twitter.
The best Twitters. You know.
They call it the Tweety.
Yeah, they're all tweeting.
We could probably open it up for questions from the audience now, because we don't have a lot of time, so I'm going to take as many questions as I possibly can. Please.
Well, I just think everyone's familiar with the whole story, the narrative of the lies about weapons of mass destruction, but I think the point is, I want to go on about the issue of Kosovo. It's quite uncanny about how when NATO was bombing Kosovo, we were told that there were going to be mass graves discovered. I mean, to be precise, US Defense Secretary William Cohen said on, you know, TV news, he said that up to 100,000 possible. Well, he said could, okay, up to 100,000 people could be discovered. And I'm just thinking that it's thinking of the parallels, seeing them, of course, by the autumn of 1999. Again, it came to, there were no mass graves. Because of the images of Srebrenica, obviously there's this, many people obviously had this belief. And just and also another point is that it's been said, very important, that Robert Marshall Andrews, Labour MP, has written that Tony Blair got his messianic complex from Kosovo.
I think it was much earlier on than that with his messianic complex. I think happened shortly around birth, actually, but so I wouldn't blame it on Kosovo entirely. The coverage of Kosovo is very interesting, actually, when you look at it, bring it back to the media, not just what
people like Cohen said. I mean, if you run through all the newspapers, it's very similar to the lead up to the invasion of Iraq. You know, the 45 minutes and the weapons of mass destruction, the same, you know, the same kind of propaganda went out before the attack on Yugoslavia, attack on Serbia.
The deceit in their own earlier courts, which is used as an excuse to trigger.
Yeah, so it I mean, I suppose that's the point. It's not new. It happens. I feel it really is about time that those who train and teach young journalists really start to teach them to be skeptical, not of their readers and viewers and listeners, but skeptical of, if you like, their employers. They're skeptical of governments. Now, some journalists will say, oh, but we are, you know, we look through narrow eyes at politicians and so on. But yes, up to a point, Lord Copper, you know, but skeptical of the overall intentions of governments, no. Governments are still portrayed as the words we and us are used. Governments are still portrayed as essentially well-meaning and benign if they're ours. If they're somebody else's, they're not. And so I just feel certainly much foreign reporting is done in terms of the usefulness or expendability of countries and societies. There are many specifics to that. But I think it's about time that was introduced into the teaching of journalists instead of merely running jobs factories. So the whole thing is recycled again.
A question at the back.
Kavi, John, I invite you to speculate.
Sorry?
I invite you to speculate.
Speculate?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
The Wahhabi Salafi year zero, will it occur in Afghanistan, Syria?
No. Year zero, you shouldn't really take what happened in Cambodia or Timor or any other country and say this will happen in another country. They're all different. Certainly great suffering happens in other countries. There's no doubt that the huge suffering in Iraq was underplayed for years, and the only really credible peer-reviewed academic survey of that epic crime in Iraq was poo-pooed by the media for years. But when you look at the FOI reports of what the Blair government actually thought of it, they thought it was right. So I suppose that's a kind of year zero in a sense. But it's understanding that our governments, along with the dictators of the world, are capable of doing to other people, if not to their own people, but to other people, that which we only accredit to our official demons. That's something that I don't think has any real currency in the media. And why should it, frankly? Because I said at the beginning, I do believe that the media, for which I've worked in the mainstream, is an extension. But when we recognize that it's an extension of power, then we become, as Martha Gellhorn once said, we become aware of, as she put it, official drivel, and we understand that truth basically is subversive. It always is.
I was just wondering, more on a subjective level, what actually motivates you in the things you do, and also the power of, rather than left or right or up and down, it's about, is it about compassion, the power of compassion with you, what you do?
I couldn't describe. I mean, Charlie did broach how personally I do it. I've always felt that being a journalist is an enormous privilege. Being allowed to go into people's lives, gaining their trust, being able to go and find out what the hell is going on is a huge privilege. And I pursued that as a journalist. I've never put a label on myself. Plenty of labels have been stuck on me, but I've never put one on myself. And I can't now start to analyze exactly why I did it. I gave you a glimpse of that in my own development growing up. I think that had something to do with it, but certainly the shock of seeing how most of the world lived, coming from a comfortable early life, undoubtedly had an effect.
We'll have time for two more questions after this because it's nearly 8:30.
I'd like to ask you a question about a very contemporary issue, which is Julian Assange. I've lived in Australia for about 15 years. My children, who have grown up, are still living there. So I know what the situation is like in Australia very much, the politics. I was talking to a barrister friend of mine the other day about whether the Australian government could be prosecuted for not taking enough care, for not doing what they're meant to do under international law to protect Julian Assange, given that he's had death threats. Now, I don't know whether that's possible or not, but if so, it would be great if you could have a quick word with Julian Burnside, QC over there.
I was with Julian Burnside last night, actually. And we went round to see the political refugee and the Ecuadorian embassy together. So Julian is on the case. I don't think there's much hope of the Australian government being prosecuted, but the objective is to bring pressure on the Australian government to extend the rights of protection that all its citizens have. They have those rights, and Assange has those, and they've denied them, willfully denied them, in, as we know from FOI searches, they've denied them in collusion with the US, which has prepared an indictment of him. We don't know what the actual prosecution is. What he's done, of course, is perfectly lawful under the First Amendment of the US Constitution. But they've tried to cook up something under a draconian Espionage Act was brought in during the First World War. They might try something on copyright, but it'll be a concoction. And he may not even be charged. If he's extradited to the US, he could disappear. I mean, not disappear literally, but he could disappear into one of the hell holes that are now reserved for post 9/11 dissidents, really, and certainly for truth tellers. No president has pursued more truth tellers in history than Barack Obama. Not even George Bush, who threatened to. There's only a couple, but this one is after them.
John, I read recently...
Where are you? Sorry?
I'm sorry, I'm here.
Ah, yes.
I read reports of CIA agents on the border of Syria helping to arm rebels within Syria. I just wonder, what is your assessment of what's going on in that country, the conflict and the power struggle? It seems very confusing. What is your analysis of it?
I almost feel that Charles is better equipped to answer that, and maybe Charles, you'd like to, but I mean, I'll just throw
it's
in.
It's your evening.
Right, okay.
I don't think we'll disagree.
Sorry, I'm not.
But Charles has really done some terrific work on Syria and getting people to understand the complexities of it. Looking at the media portrayal of Syria, it's a black and white situation, and the terrible massacre in Hula was immediately put down to the Assad regime, and no one is suggesting this is not a very brutal regime. The Baathists have always been brutal. In fact, they helped the Americans with their rendition program, and they've been a thoroughly, particularly under his father, been a thoroughly nasty regime. But Syrian society is a complex society, and the precarious stability in that country, when you consider that part of it is occupied by Israel, and it has next to it Lebanon, and with its recent history and upheavals, it's a very precarious society. There's no doubt that in Western terms, Syria is the road to Iran, but I don't think they really know how to go down that road, otherwise they would have bombed it by now, and that wouldn't really have met their objectives. There is no question that the rebels, so-called rebels, and all of them, are being supported and backed by the West. It reminds me very much of Central America, of El Salvador, of Nicaragua especially, of the Contra War in Nicaragua. I'm not equating in any shape or form the Sandinista regime with the Assad regime, they're night and day. But the only way forward in Syria, as in many, many situations, is that there is what used to be called, and it's difficult to use the word, diplomacy. There has to be a debate and discussion between all of those who are bearing down on Syria at the moment, but no peace will happen, I believe, in any of the countries of the Middle East. No real peace will happen until Palestine gets the justice that is due to it. I think that is the central, that is the cockpit almost of Middle East difficulties, problems, injustices, and so on. I think that even those who attacked NATO and London and Washington, those who attacked Libya and Afghanistan and Iraq and doing all sorts of things in Yemen and Somalia, draw back at the moment, and I may be proved wrong, I hope I'm not, from attacking Syria. They can afford to do that when they have proxies. Syria, the killing, almost the disintegration, I mean, I would think that if Syria fell apart in the way that Libya did, it would be a disaster for the majority of the population. Would you
agree? As with Iraq.
As with Iraq.
Iraq,
and that was a disaster. It opened up sectarian wars. It opened up the kind of divisions that went there. I traveled through Iraq in 1998, and yes, it was, you know, the regime was strict and a police state and people disappeared and so on. But what was striking to me was that up and down the country, people very proudly proclaimed themselves as Iraqis. I doubt whether I'd maybe I'd find that now. I doubt it, actually. The country was just blown apart, and I believe that was always the design, to divide it, in the end, of course, the United States ended up having a country now apparently closely allied to Iran, which wasn't the goal at the beginning. But Syria has to be negotiated. Whatever the problems are in Syria, whatever the budding sectarian problems, they have to be negotiated. And what has happened all over the world in the last, particularly the last dozen years, is the denigration of the very notion of negotiation, of honest brokers, of good faith, of trying to bring together. And we're not being idealistic here, this is how things have to be, of regional solutions, if you like. The United States, especially since 9/11, has said no to that. They must be training a whole breed of so-called diplomats that don't even know what diplomacy is, because that's out the window now.
So one last question. Thank you.
James Thacker, a novelist. I don't know if Charlie would agree with me as a Vietnam generation, but you're quiet. Patient tone is something I personally envy. And we were dealing at Index with Willie and whatever doing the Khmer Rouge thing, so I know what it took, the courage it took you to go into these countries. Can I turn to that courage now and ask you to say what you really think about America? Harold Pinter could hardly contain himself, and I mean, it wasn't hard to agree with him, but how bad is it? You've been watching 72 interventions. How bad is it? How bad will it get? And can it be contained?
You know how bad it is. Well, I look, the films, the work says, you know, it's interesting that in recent years, the term anti-American has gone. Not gone altogether, but I used to get that a lot, of anti-American. You know, I wasn't anti-British, and I wasn't anti-Australian, and I made lots of critical films and about them. I wasn't anti-India, but anti-American, the holy centre. That seems to have gone. I think because the level of awareness about great power and rapacious America has risen very considerably. I think that's one of the really hopeful signs, that people are more aware. They don't quite know what to do with the awareness often, but awareness has risen. You know, I think any warlike great power that seeks to impose this power on other countries, as the United States has been doing through most of my lifetime, I'm always think it's an amazing stroke of luck that I wasn't blown to bits along with all of you, perhaps by nuclear weapons in my lifetime. The U.S. came close to using them after it did use them, but that has been. That has been the great unsayable, because in this country, this is sort of America light or whatever it is. The foreign policy of the United Kingdom is an extension of US foreign policy, pretty much. The foreign policy of Australia is entirely the foreign policy of the United States. And so it goes through many other countries, including Europe. A real discussion of that, a real debate about that, a real challenge to that among in journalism would begin perhaps to free our minds somewhat.
Thanks very much. Now, just before we go, I want to say that John's body of work from the time he began to now, and it's this is not a eulogy because he's going to be with us for a long time, includes not only these films but books, articles. It is an impressive body of work for any journalist, and I think we should all be grateful that he could come tonight and talk to us and share some of that, what he's learned and what he's gained and what he's told us over the years tonight. So if we could thank him.